This is Sandy Ligren speaking off screen. Thank you everybody for coming today. We're so excited to come via 93 degree weather in Burbank. Mr. Matt Daigle, and some of you might be familiar with his work and be fangirls and fanboys. Me too. So I'm thrilled that he's here. I want to take a moment to thank the Multicultural Committee who sponsored this event today. Yay! And without further ado, Matt Daigle. And Matt, I will be your clicker, so tell me when to advance.
Okay, awesome. Thank you. Thank you so much, Sandy. I appreciate it. I'm really excited for this presentation. I want to introduce my wife, Kay. That's who you're hearing. This is not my voice. This is my wife's voice. Okay, this is not what I sound like. Okay. Of course, again, I wanted to stress that we're very excited to meet all you and be here with you. This is the first time I've done a Skype presentation. So normally I go to workshops in colleges and elementary schools. So I'm feeling a little bit awkward with this, just a little bit. So just be patient with me if you don't mind. But we will definitely have fun. Okay? Now, typically, when you meet a deaf person, they tend to first talk about their background, where they were born, where they're from, where they went to school. I decided to hold that part for this presentation. I wanted you guys to recognize me as a deaf humorist first, my cartooning first. So that's me, that deaf guy, cartoon, and that deaf cartoonist. We're going to talk about art first, and then we'll talk about me being a deaf person. Okay? So many people know that I'm a deaf cartoonist, but I really first identify myself as an artist, and then the fact that I'm deaf. Okay? Now, next panel, please. Next slide. I grew up loving art. As a deaf person, of course, it's very visual, and I take in the world visually. My family was very supportive of me being an artist, too, and they love art. We always went to different art museums. My mom and dad were always dragging me to different places. They bought art books. I got to take art classes, so I was exposed to that, especially my mother. My mother is an artist as well, so we shared a lot of similar likes about our enjoyment of art and appreciation of art. Now, art is very accessible to a deaf person. It's very visual. So there's stories that are told through art, and there's different styles of art, different types of visual mediums of art. So a deaf person has total access to that because, of course, we can't hear, but we can see art. And I, in particular, love humor. I love humor because my family's very humorous. We love to joke around with one another, and we did that a lot. And I love cartoons in particular. Saturday morning, I would watch for the newspaper, and I would be so excited. And of course, I would look forward to Saturday morning cartoons. I'm sure you guys did as well as kids. Everybody was about Saturday morning cartoons. How many of you love cartoons on Saturday morning? Me too. I couldn't wait to watch the cartoons. Of course, cartoons in the newspaper. My parents really encouraged me to read the newspapers and to look at those comics, the daily comics and the Sunday comics. And I never, ever thought I would become a cartoonist because I was young and I did love them and I did appreciate art and I would be able to copy it. And like, for example, I loved Garfield the cat. I would be able to copy him. And Snoopy, I would be able to draw Snoopy from Peanuts. I was able to do that. They inspired me to draw. But I also love to read comic books. I loved looking at comics on TV as well. Okay, next panel, please. At that time, my role models were Charles Schulz from Peanuts, Jim Davis, of course, for Garfield, the cat, and of course, Bill Watterson for Calvin and Hobbes. Those were my role models. I loved those three cartoons. Those were my favorite, and they inspired me as a child. I would study and read their cartoons all the time. And I also had another favorite cartoonist. I don't know if you guys are familiar with them. The Far Side. Gary Larson's The Far Side. I don't know if you guys are familiar with The Far Side. He was very famous in the 90s, early 90s. And then he retired. I think he retired like in 1995 after 15 or 20 years. He had a very short career, but his work mixed humor with animals and people, not attractive people, outrageously goofy, ridiculous, absurd people. And he would just show what's called a one-panel cartoon, single panel. I love that because it was so visual. You would look at it, it would tell a story immediately, you would get the punchline, and you would get the whole thing in one small single panel. So, before I move on, I was inspired by them, by these three cartoonists. My mother knew that I was very fond of Gary Larson, and he had an exhibit at a museum. And it showed his original drawings, very simple black and white renderings in ink and on paper. And there was a whole huge exhibit. I was thinking it was 12 at the time. And that really started me thinking about becoming a cartoonist as a profession, because up to that point, I didn't know that I could. And it was all in a museum, simple drawings, not elaborate fine art paintings that you normally see or sculptures. People would identify that as art. But I didn't realize that drawing cartoons like Gary Larson did would end up in a museum. And that's what I wanted. I wanted that for myself. So that got me really motivated to become a cartoonist myself. Now you have to understand, cartoonists at that time may not see the kind of, career that other artists do. They're maybe not as popular or as well known. They are self-starters. They have to learn by themselves. There was no place to really go and study cartooning, particularly. So it was difficult for me. Like, where would I go to college to learn cartooning? So I just had to learn on my own. I was self-taught, so to speak. Okay, we can go to the next slide. Okay, this is one of my early drawings. I was age 5. I was very motivated at that time to learn how to draw. It's a bear. It's one of my stuffed animals. I learned to actually copy what I would see. And I would use either a pencil or a pen or markers, something very simple, whatever supplies I had on hand. And I just taught myself. Then when I entered high school, of course, I joined the art club. I loved art so much that I got involved in all of those art classes and art clubs, and I did painting. And we also had a newspaper. And someone approached me and said, would you like to join our newspaper and do some art for our newspaper? And I thought, well, this will be great. I will be able to actually publish some of my art. So this next slide will show some of my early art in high school. This is me in high school. Wow. Back in the, you know, back in the day, I was blonde. That was my early high school artwork. And I really enjoyed that. It was a very fun experience. If you see the top cartoon, it was related to whether or not in the state of Texas, at that time, whether or not young students should get, like, it was a political cartoon about getting a driver's license. They felt that you needed to graduate from high school. If you graduated from high school, you would get a driver's license. But if you dropped out, they would cut up your driver's license. So it was kind of a political thing going on. So our school newspaper wanted to do an article about it. And a lot of students complained about it, and there was this big thing. So they asked me to draw a political cartoon for their opinion section, their opinion article. And then the cartoon underneath it was a person for talking about how to grow your money, invest, and so it was about sitting under a money tree. Then the money's falling on him. You notice the shoes and the shades, it's really 1980s. That was the trend, you know, the Converse and whatnot, Converse tennis shoes. So, during my senior year, I was picked as one of the top three cartoonists for the school newspapers in the state of Texas, which was a huge honor for me. So then that really inspired me even more to pursue my art. And then after high school, I went to college, of course, that's what we do. And I continued working on cartoons, even though they didn't really provide any cartoon classes on technique. I had to continue to just do art and cartoon on my own. When I was in college, I did get hired to work at the college newspaper as well. And that was fun. So I was able to show some of my work. And let's go to the next slide and I'll show you that. NSU is for Northern State University. That's where I graduated from in advertising design. That was my major. Like I said, they didn't have a cartooning major, but I was still cartooning while I was in college and working on my advertising design degree. And you can see I had some cartoons about final exams, like the different hairdos, pulling your hair out, those kinds of things. And also the other cartoon was one about spring break. You might be wondering why I have a wolf. That's because the wolf was Northern State University's mascot. Northern Wolves. Okay, I'm gonna go to the next panel. Oh wait, before I do that though, I said we were going to the next panel. You went back. Oh, you can go to the next panel if you like, Sandy. That's fine. After college, I was looking for a job, and there wasn't really any cartooning jobs really available. There's a lot of volunteering that you have to do to get your work out there. So I would work with community services for the deaf. And we lived in South Dakota, and I was a graphic designer at the time. We developed a new deaf newspaper. That organization was called, and the newspaper was called Sign News. And when we launched that, I knew that I wanted to be, you know, have my cartoons in that newspaper. And that was a wonderful opportunity. Because specifically, this was a newspaper for deaf people, so deaf-related cartoons would fit beautifully, and I was super excited because I got paid for it. Yay! And it was really fun. It was a wonderful experience. And it helped me learn the ropes, definitely. I mentioned Gary Larson, The Far Side. He had a single panel style. I needed to develop my own style. So some of these cartoons, I copied his one panel concept. So it was called in deaf culture, dot, 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 meaning so many things about deaf culture that can be humorous or funny. And the reason I named it that is because many people will say, why do deaf people do this? Or why do deaf people do that? Why do they flash the lights? Well, then you have to explain, well, in deaf culture, they do this or that or the other thing. Well, why is it not okay for me to duck between two people when they're signing? Those kinds of things. It's better just to walk through them. It's deaf culture stuff, you know. In deaf culture, we do this, X, Y, and Z. So I did a cartoon about the different points of view of that. And then, as you can see, I did one about lip reading, a deaf Jedi lip reading nightmare, you know. I love Star Wars, I'm a big fan. So I thought to myself, what would happen if you had a deaf Jedi? That would be really difficult to be signed because we've got all these, you know, I've got Chewbacca. Yoda. No, he's got, you know, really doesn't enunciate very well. And then, of course, bearded Obi-Wan Kenobi. We know that it's hard for deaf people to read lips on someone who has a lot of facial hair. But the worst of the worst, of course, is Darth Vader. So. So I was able to, all my inspirations that deaf culture gave me, I was able to funnel into these cartoons in Sign News. The next cartoon is extreme interpreting. You know, that time everybody was talking about extreme sports. We're going to do extreme this, we're going to do extreme that. And we thought, well, what would be the extreme experience for an interpreter? Well, rock climbing would be one. You know, rappelling. And of course, I love the fact that she's got high heels on, dangling the line. You know, because deaf people climb, you know. So, next panel, please. And here's another example of my kind of Gary Larson-esque one panel cartoon. The cartoon, I don't know if you guys can see it well enough, but it's a caveman that is frozen. And they say that it's a deaf caveman, but how do you know that it's a deaf caveman? Does anybody have a clue how you know? Right, he's signing help. Help! He's frozen. He's calling and now he's frozen. So that was the humor of that, how they identified that the caveman was actually deaf. Deaf people always wonder, were there deaf cavemen back then? Well, of course there were. Deaf people have always been, you know. And how would we show that? How would we write about that and make it funny? So that's one of my favorite cartoons. And then the next comic strip is about interpreters. You know, interpreters are very serious. Their jobs are very serious. They always do their job. They're very professional. But what if you had one interpreter who wanted to do an April Fool's joke? What would they do? Like have like their arm tucked behind and then have a fake arm that pops off. You know, why not? Just to make a joke. Okay, next panel. So I started a freelance business later on in my life. Now, before that, I worked with communication services for the deaf. I worked in the newspaper. I enjoyed it tremendously. And then Kay and I had a baby. Yay! We were so excited. We had a new member of our family. But time to have careers and raise our child the way that we wanted to just was too much for us. So I decided to be a stay-at-home dad. Kay would continue being an interpreter, and then I would start my own graphic design freelance business. Like I said before, I have a degree in graphic design, advertising design, so I was able to do that to make money. And then cartooning was kind of a side job that I would pick up later, here and there. And the name of my company was The Graphics Guy. And I've been doing that for 20 years. Well, Hayden's 10. Well, so my freelance business has been around 10 years. So. And I'm still doing it. I'm still doing graphic design. I still do that. Now, so you can see some samples of some of my graphic design work, layout work. And sometimes I would get hired by deaf companies. Like, for example, you would see some that would use hand shapes, sign language in the logo designs, in the text. Some friends that I had owned deaf businesses. And so I always wanted to incorporate hand shapes into the designs. So it was deaf friendly. It was more fun. It was more creative for me to do. It was fun to do. And one that I'm very proud of is Deaf Nation. I don't know if you guys are very familiar with that, but they had the World Deaf Expo, and I was asked to design their logo. And if there is a Deaf Expo in your area, I really suggest that you go. In 2016, there's going to be the Deaf Expo in Las Vegas, and it's going to be the World Deaf Expo. I think this is the fourth one that we've had. People from all over the world will be coming. So you will see every variety of deaf people. It is amazing. I want to say over 30, 40,000 people attend. It is huge for 1 week. And you see so many people from different cultures. It's fantastic, from different countries. Great experience. Okay. And here are some examples of my graphic design work anyway. And here's some more for the next slide. I did some art that you can see I kind of incorporated some of my cartooning into some of my graphic design work that I would do on the computer. This one with the dog treats, and I worked on some mascots for schools for the deaf, for deafhood. Okay, next panel. And then the next one, you'll see the four legs and the signing Santa Claus. And the one that was really big, I won the International Breastfeeding Icon competition. I don't know if any of you guys have ever seen that, but that was international symbol. Imagine, you can see that anywhere. You can see it all over the world. I've seen it in airports. Oftentimes you will see them near the bathrooms. And it's a symbol to welcome breastfeeding families, mothers. Hospitals use my symbol. It was a great honor. And it was a great experience in developing that symbol or that icon. So now if you see this icon anywhere, you know the person who created it. Okay? Yeah, I know that guy. Okay, we'll go to the next panel then. Not only did I do logos and graphic designs, brochures, all kinds of print work, but I also did some cartooning, some comics for ZVRS, which is a video relay service. And I've been working with them for many years. I do different kinds of cartoons for them. I do comic pages, like one pages for them for advertising. And it's fun, so I was able to use some of my cartooning skills still. You know, the same skills that I was trying to keep up with since high school when I first started. So it was important to me. Now the next panel. Okay. Then we went to Marceline. Okay, I want to talk about that, but I want to first talk about, okay, in deaf culture, those cartoons were very successful. I enjoyed them. Deaf people liked them. But Sign News, that newspaper, went under. So that was disappointing and sad. So I was trying to figure out what I could do with my cartooning, because I still wanted to do that, and how I could impact people nationwide. Could I become syndicated? A syndication is when a particular company basically takes on your cartoon and sells it to newspapers, and you can become nationwide then. Those syndicated companies will make sure your cartoons make it into the newspapers. I wasn't sure if I was gonna do a single panel or if I was actually gonna do a comic strip. I was trying to come up with some ideas. But then there was a huge cartoon convention in Marceline, Missouri, which was not very far from where we were living at the time, about a 4-hour drive. So we decided to go. We wanted to see what it was going to be like to be around some cartoonists, professional cartoonists, and ask them some questions about their life as cartoonists. That's something you do as cartoonists. You go to conventions. Back at that time, did we have internet? I don't even remember if we had internet. It was a little expensive. I think I had a computer, but we didn't have social media like we do now. But there was an event that we found out about on the internet, so we went. And it was a fantastic experience. We met many professional, well-known cartoonists from newspapers. If you were to open up a newspaper, we met many of them. That Marceline is the birthplace, or I believe Marceline is the town where Walt Disney grew up. I don't know if he was born there, but he grew up there. So there's a lot of history there with cartooning. So that's why Marceline, Missouri. And I believe they have that every year. Well, have you ever heard of the cartoon For Better or For Worse? Lynn Johnston. Now she's retired. And also Mike Peters. He has the cartoon with the dog. It's called Mother Goose and Grimm. Those are two very funny, very popular cartoons. I love them. Those two people are fantastic people. They're really incredible people. They're very successful. They're very well known. I met both of them at two different times, but I met them there at Marceline. I showed them my work, and they said, wow, you're talented. Your work is wonderful. They really enjoyed my work. I said, how do I get out there? How do I get syndicated? How do people find out about my work? Because I was trying to figure out my niche. Like, what I was doing a lot of stuff related to deaf culture, but how could I get out in the mainstream hearing population? How would my cartoonies fit that broader audience? Well, Lynn Johnston looked at my work. Her work is about family. For Better or For Worse is about her family. About her husband, raising children. I think she has 3 children, something like that. A dog, a rabbit, the whole 9 yards. Okay, well, she said, now at that time, we had our son Hayden. He was little. I want to say he was about 1 year old. And Lynn was fascinated about our family, how we signed together and how Kay interpreted for me and whatnot out in the world. And she was wondering about our lives. How are you, what is your family like? I want to know about your family. And then Mike Peters said, draw what you know. You've got to create a cartoon about what you know. So my wife and I, on the road trip back to South Dakota, where we lived at the time, Kay came up with the idea of that deaf guy.
Yes.
So let's go to the next panel. And that deaf guy was born from that trip. We worked on it for about 2 years. I developed it in the beginning. Now you can see the three characters. Got Desmond, D for Desmond, deaf. Is kind of the nice guy, kind of passive, stay-home dad, pretty much like me. But my hair is different than his. And then you've got Helen, and of course, that's my wife, Kay. Very strong advocate for deaf people. She's all about education. She's an interpreter too. So very much involved in deaf culture. And then you've got the little boy named Cedric. And that's the troublemaker, a little bit of a troublemaker. Because he's in between two worlds, hearing and deaf, and he's considered a coda, which is a child of a deaf adult. Right now, he's a coda with a K because he's a kid of a deaf adult. And deaf culture has kind of rules about that. 18 above, it's spelled with a C. Age 18 and below is spelled with a K. So that's how the story began of that deaf guy. So that was our specific chemistry. And I want to believe I started that in 2010, 2009, something like that. 2010 is when we launched it on Facebook. Okay.
Oh.
Okay, let me, I skipped something. Okay, Kay objected and said, oh, you forgot to say something. First, I started on my own, but it didn't work. I'm not really great with ideas. Are writing the comic strip. I mean, I do have good ideas, and I do have that ability, but I'm really not great with addressing the broader audience of deaf and hearing. I like to focus on deaf culture, but then Kay joined with that deaf guy because Kay has a lot of experience with writing. Next panel. Okay, so that's her. That's Kay. She has a lot of experience with writing comedy. She's a comedy actor. And that's not what she really looks like. She's in a costume, by the way. You've already seen her, right? You know what she really looks like. She's not that blonde. That's a wig. Okay. So we worked together often. And we always love working together. And we wanted to work together on this project as well. So let me go to the next panel. When you do that, I say, next panel. Okay. She's like ahead of me. Okay. So now you can see the comic strip that we created. The first comic strip, the top comic strip is one of our very first comics that we ever did as that deaf guy. I don't know if you guys can see it. I'll let you look at it. You see the ladies watching our sign language, and they say, isn't sign language beautiful? And then Desmond says, you have to poop right now? Well, it gives kind of people reality check. The hearing community are the people who can hear that don't know sign language. Yes, sign language is beautiful. ASL is a beautiful language. But is our conversation always beautiful? Well, no, not necessarily, right? So we can't careful of what you assume when you're watching deaf people sign. They could be fighting. They could be talking about something totally disgusting. You never know. So it really depends on what the conversation is, because we're human. Deaf people are human. We talk like anybody else. We're not special. Our language isn't always so beautiful. So once we develop that deaf guy, we started to just write it from our experiences every day. Now, remember, Mike Peters, the cartoonist, that said, write what you know, or develop what you know, draw what you know. Well, that's about, we're telling the truth. Now, sometimes the truth is modified a little bit, but we present basically our experience, and that's fun for us. Instead of us trying to create something that's way above, you know, about maybe about animals or giraffe story or a cartoon about lions. Well, that doesn't make any sense. We're not connected to that. It's too complicated. It's too hard. It's outside of us. This is our daily life. This is what we experience. And this is our experience as our family. Yeah. Now, the second cartoon you can see, it's related to technology. Equipment that deaf people use, and we were being a little bit silly about how the four top inventions, you know, closed captioning was a huge for us. Closed captioning helps us watch TV and know what people are saying on TV, and of course the ability to text and one another, and video phones, being able to make a phone call and use our own language. And then of course, does anybody have a Snuggie? Raise your hand. You live in cold country. Yeah, Snuggies, man. Oh man, we can put, if you put a blanket on, a regular blanket on, well then my arms are cold if I'm signing. But if you have a Snuggie, then my arms are nice and warm. The blanket's wrapped around me, and it's perfect. So one of the top, inventions. Okay, we're going to the next panel. I'll let you look at them first. Okay, now the first one, of course, many deaf people on Facebook, when we posted this one, they were resoundingly saying, that's me. That's happened to me a million times. Of course, it's very normal. It's not like I'm different or we're different, because we don't hear what's behind us. Deaf people don't hear if somebody's approaching us or if somebody steps into our sign space. We won't hear that. So oftentimes, sign language will get a little bit wide or out of control, and I can't tell you how many times I've poked somebody in the face. Now you'll see the comic strip, That Deaf Guy, explains about deaf culture, it explains about our family, it incorporates the deaf experience and what's considered the hearing experience, and the experience of a coda. So we are able to share a lot of humor from different aspects of our lives. And the part about the grocery store is about, of course, sign language. The next one is a coda experience, our child of a deaf adult. Cedric is at school, and the teacher, now, believe it or not, this truly does happen often to deaf parents. When they go to the school, when they have a child who can hear, of course they are not going to have an interpreter on the spot. You would normally have to request an interpreter, and that does happen, that does take place. But if you were to show up at school to pick up your son and the teacher wanted to talk to you, well, there's no interpreter available. So oftentimes they'll want to use the child, the coda, as the interpreter. So we thought, well, wouldn't it be funny if the coda was a little bit manipulative and was a little bit smarter? Because he knows he's in trouble. So he would you know, they want to talk about, the teacher wants to talk about math, and he's like, nope, not even you know. He's got the power, right? I'm a little bit of a smart aleck. Okay, next panel. Oh, before I do that, many CODAs really enjoy our comic strip. They feel they're represented, and their identity is displayed in our comics. And CODAs sometimes feel that, you know, they're left out of the larger deaf culture, but they are a very important group in the deaf culture. They're part of the family. They have their first language many times is American Sign Language. So CODAs really enjoy our comic strip. Okay, next panel. I'll let you read it. Okay, that's an actual true story, based on true events, except Kay doesn't sleep in rollers. I'm going to emphasize that. She does not sleep in rollers, so don't visualize her in rollers. But it actually did happen. In the middle of the night, Kay woke up to a terrible sound. She couldn't figure out what it was. We had just moved to this house. It was new to us, so we didn't really know the house that well. And of course, I couldn't hear the sound. So I kept asking her, what does it sound like? What does it sound like? But of course, you know, sometimes a hearing person would think, why would a deaf person ask what something sounds like? We don't really understand sound, maybe, but we do have common sense about what sound makes for certain things. So I was questioning her, and of course, Kay was like freaked out and called 911 anyway. And so the cops came and they were like, well, no problem, we'll look around. And they said, you know what, your husband's right. The gate was hitting up against the house. And so I was right the whole time. I was the one that figured out what the sound was by the description of what Kay gave me. So she was a little bit embarrassed about that. But that's a fact. Many deaf people have experienced that in their past. Someone, like, for example, oftentimes deaf people say, I heard something. It actually means that they felt something. Like, I have a sense of something, I feel something. Like, I'll be in the kitchen washing the dishes or something, and it's kind of loud. I know that it's very loud when I wash the dishes, but I have a sense that my son fell or dropped something. And I'll come out and say, is everything okay? He says, how do you know I fell, that I dropped something? I said, well, I felt the vibrations on the floor, and they traveled. Well, we have a small house. Now, if I lived in a really big house, then I would have a problem. But in a small house, I can feel the house all over. I can feel the vibrations of anything happening. I'm very sensitive that way. That's one advantage of being deaf, is you have a real great sense of feeling things. Okay, so I'll let you read the next one. This was a holiday humor, call it from the CODA point of view. Okay, so you can see this was, again, from a CODA's point of view. You know, a little mischievous guy, always trying to be a smart aleck, where there, you know, so many, you know, poor Santa Claus is being so, you know, sweet to him, and You know, he's saying, well, if you know so much Santa, do you know ASL, American Sign Language? And also, you know, if Santa asks him, what does he want for Christmas? He says, well, I want you to shave, because oftentimes Santa's, you know, the deaf person can't read Santa's lips because of the beard, can't read the lips. So it's very nice of our coda to think of the deaf, his deaf father, of course. Okay, now the next panel. This is our website. I cropped it so it would fit on the PowerPoint, but this is the website that we have, and it's www.deafguy.com. And of course, we have a Facebook page, but this is our website, and we have all of that Deaf Guy archived. So if you look down at the bottom, you can see a calendar, and you can click on any of them, or you can do the back button or the forward button. And we've got those from 2010. Every cartoon that we've posted since 2010 in there. And that's another comic strip that we did about lights going off and on in our house. That happens all the time. Because it's important to have lights on in, you know, with a deaf person. But we always thought, our neighbors must think our house is haunted or we've got poltergeist or something. Because our lights are always flashing. This shows you a part of deaf culture and what we need in terms of communication. We need lights. And oftentimes we have to do cartoons that help people who can hear understand our culture a little bit better. That's why Kay and I work so closely together with the different comic strips. We have to have a balance where deaf people will enjoy it, but hearing people who can hear will enjoy it as well. You know, we want everyone to be able to enjoy it and laugh or learn or be educated or whatever.
Have fun.
Okay. Now I'm gonna kind of hurry things up a little bit. And now, and we also have a store. We sell books. The blue book that you see is our second book called That Deaf Guy, A Wild Ride. Book one is already sold out. It's gone. We will reprint it next year. Right now we're just focusing on We also have a deck of cards. I'll show you. Oh. See? So you see our characters. Well, that's our logo on the back. And then the numbers are in sign language. Do you guys see that? And then, of course, the king is my character, Desmond. I'm the king, and I'm signing king. And of course, it's a regular deck of cards. And it's great. People love it. It's fun. My good friends and I, we play poker, and we use the That Deaf Guy cards. And also, it's great for kids to learn some of the numbers and just a few letters like, you know, king, queen, and whatnot. They're the first ones to see this. We haven't launched it. You guys will be the first ones to see it. You guys want to see it? We're so excited about this. We picked them up yesterday, hot off the press. And we're going to be at this Saturday at the LA Deaf Festival in Los Angeles. And we'll have them online to order on Monday. You guys ready? The big unveiling. Calendar. It's our new That Deaf Guy calendar. So it has cartoons in it, of course. Can you guys see it? So we're very excited for that. And it also has deaf culture dates on the calendar, like the birthdays of famous deaf people, Deaf Awareness Day, Interpreter Appreciation Day, gotta have that. So many of those things. And this panel, oh, the next panel, please, is our Facebook page, and that's www.facebook.com/thatdeafguycomic. And people like to, this is where you can share our comic strip. We'll be looking for, be looking for our new comic because tomorrow, because we post every Thursday. Okay, now, next, the next panel. My life story. Real quickly. And now you know about that deaf guy, me as a cartoonist, my art background, now my life story, condensed, abridged. I hope you guys have been waiting patiently for that, maybe. Okay. Really? I was born deaf. And I was raised by a family who could hear. No one's deaf. My mom and my dad and my older sister. Everybody is hearing. I was born profoundly deaf. I cannot hear anything. I have nerve damage, so I'm considered profoundly deaf. My parents weren't sure what to do. I think I was about 6 months that they realized that there was something wrong. So they took me to the doctor, of course, and the doctor tested me, and at that time, my parents had no exposure to deaf culture, found out that I was profoundly deaf. My parents just followed what the doctors said, and they really encouraged an oral education, meaning no sign language, just learning to read lips and speak. And it took a lot of training, required so much work. Oh, one thing I want to add, my dad was in the military. He was in the Army. And he was a physical therapist and had a PhD, and we had to move a lot. I was an Army brat, that's what they call that, I know. But I really enjoyed it though. I liked moving around. And it was fantastic because moving from city to city exposed me to different schools and different educational philosophies. I went to an oral school. To fourth grade. I was oral up until fourth grade. Can you imagine? No interpreter in the classroom. I was reading the teacher's lips and speaking. That was not my preferred way of learning, definitely. Then we moved, and that was in Colorado. I was living in Colorado at that time. They really were focusing on oralism in that state at that time. And then we moved to the East Coast. And of course, there was more exposure to actual deaf culture and sign language because of Gallaudet University and ASL. So they had actual deaf programs on the East Coast, and I was mainstream. I was mainstreamed all my life. I never attended a school for the deaf. I was mainstream, meaning I went to a school that had maybe a deaf program, but I was in a class with all hearing students. And I also was involved in a total communication class, which was kind of sign language, kind of signing Englishy and talking and signing at the same time. I was super excited to learn sign language. I felt so much more comfortable than having to speak and reading lips. You can see that my cartoons have a lot of lip reading aspects to them because of that, because of my experience of growing up oral in the beginning of my education. And then, once I started learning sign language, I went through those programs and I graduated from, after fourth grade to high school, I had to have an interpreter in the classroom because once I learned ASL, there was no going back. That was what I needed for my communication and I wanted that. And I was the only deaf oftentimes in the classroom. And there were some on the East Coast, some deaf students in deaf programs. But when I moved back to Texas and graduated from high school, I was the only deaf. It was a huge 5A, what's considered a 5A school. I was the only deaf person. And I had my interpreter who went with me everywhere. And that was a new experience for that school. They had never had a deaf person, but they were wonderful. That was a wonderful high school. I was involved in a lot of things. I was in the art club. I was president of an art club. I was involved. I played soccer. I joined a wrestling team. I was the cartoonist in the newspaper. Let me think what else. I did a lot of stuff. I had a lot of friends. I was in advanced AP classes. I loved biology. I loved the subjects. Then I went to college at the National Technical Institute for the Deaf, and that's in Rochester, New York. And that's a huge school for the deaf that is under the auspices of the Rochester Institute of Technology. And I felt great because I'd already been mainstreamed. But when I got to NTID, I had deaf culture shock. I had never been around that many deaf people my entire life. And I was home. I was so happy. I completely immersed myself in deaf culture. I was so excited. Many of my friends went to a school for the deaf. I was so jealous that they had that kind of exposure to deaf people and that ease of communication in school, because I had such a hard time communicating in the classroom. You know, if the interpreter wasn't there in the classroom, I had to read my classmates' lips, and that wasn't always fun, but at NTID, I had full access, and it completely changed my life. My experience and my appreciation of deaf culture was sharpened because of the contrasting experience. So I quickly wanted to get involved in something that I'd always loved, which was theater. In high school, I met a lot of students who were in the theater department, and many of my friends were too. Those people that were in the theater department were very comfortable talking with a deaf person. Do you guys know why? Do you have any idea? They had no background in sign language, because theater people, actors, feel very comfortable about expressing themselves. They don't mind miming something out. They don't mind, you know, looking silly, maybe miming and acting things out, even though they didn't know sign language. So I became friends with many of them, and I really enjoyed them. But I couldn't get involved in the theater in high school because nobody had ever heard of a deaf person being involved in theater. But at NTID, they have an outstanding theatrical program and art department. So when I was there, I had the opportunity to join a traveling theater company called Sunshine 2. It comprised of three deaf people, three deaf students, three deaf professionals, three actors, and three hearing actors. And we traveled all over the United States putting on shows and educating people about deaf culture. And that's how I met my wife, Kay. So we worked together. And then after we met, we moved to South Dakota. I know, like, why? That's weird. Middle of nowhere. I went to go to South Dakota. And that's because Kay got a job as an actress there. And we had we don't like the snow. We really enjoyed it there, but we didn't like the snow. It was very cold. We're over living in states with snow. There's way too much snow in South Dakota. Anyway, so after that, it was wonderful living there. There's wonderful people there. I went back to school. I didn't finish my degree at NTID. I went to Northern State University and graduated from Northern State University in graphic design, advertising design. And again, I was the only deaf person. And who was my interpreter? You can guess. Who was my interpreter? Who do you think? Anybody guess? Yes, my wife was my interpreter. It was such a small college, they didn't even have any interpreters. There was no interpreters available. So Kay also became the director of disability services there. And she ran that office. And she exposed people to deaf culture and disabilities as a larger group to have access at the school. Now, our goal from Sunshine 2 what we learned from Sunshine 2 was to expand our experience with deaf culture to people out there that have never been exposed to it. And our mission was to educate, to make laugh, of course, to have those kinds of shows. And we've been basically doing that ever since, because that's what we're doing with that deaf guy. We're not doing shows per se, theatrical shows, but that's what our comic strip is doing. Exactly. We wanted to merge the two cultures together for both cultures to enjoy the humor about our family, about deaf culture, or how some encounters that we have, ASL, raising a child that's a coda. And we are always so surprised when we meet people that have never, ever even met a deaf person. They think deaf people can't drive, can't write, that can't raise a family. We're just flabbergasted, but can't believe it. I've always held down a job. You know, deaf people are just like anybody else, but we just can't hear, that's all. So, okay. So, that's pretty much my life. With my wife and my family, so let's see. Okay, maybe this is a great time to open it up for questions and answers.
So if anyone has a question they'd like to ask Matt, if you could come down here, there's a chair so that you can ask your question and the interpreter sitting next to you will sign it so he can see you. And if getting down here for mobility reasons is not possible, shout your question and the interpreter will interpret for you. If you are deaf and you want to sign your own question, just come in the camera. Someone must have questions.
Right there.
Questions?
Come on, be brave.
All right, we have a question.
You want me to come down there?
You can. I got you on camera. There you go. You don't have to sit if you don't want. It's up to you.
I can hear. I teach general psychology, and we were talking this morning about. In the brain cells, that there's no regenesis of many areas in the brain, and in the in hearing, I'm just wondering what you might know about research for the future to help people who have been born without with nerve damage that doesn't regenerate and heal. What hope is there in the future? Do you know anything about that for healing someone who has been born with damage to the nerve cells?
That's a really good question, and thank you so much for asking it. Okay, I was born deaf. I have complete and total nerve damage. There's no way for me to be healed that I know of. But I believe ASL is the best tool to in terms of hope and in terms of coping, because it's easy for us to communicate. Whether it be children or adult, if they can hear first when they're born, then of course they will have their memory of being able to hear, and that will have been developed in their brain because they may have lost their hearing later on. And so they may be able to use assistive technology such as hearing aids and whatnot to improve that. Often senior citizens will use a hearing aid. If someone is young, they might want to get something called a cochlear implant. Sometimes it can work, but it is not equivalent to being actually a hearing person. There's a lot of information that is missed in the brain, so it's a lot of guesswork for them, but it really depends on the individual. I can't speak for every deaf person, but for me, the fact that I can't hear, I am not really interested in being fixed or being changed. in any way. I prefer to be deaf. I'm happy to be deaf, and I'm fine with that. ASL is my preferred language. I wish that I had learned ASL in the very beginning of my life rather than being oral, because I worked so hard. I feel like I wasted a lot of my language acquisition in becoming quote unquote hearing, and that wasn't something I could ever be. And so it sort of tainted my, you know, in formative years. If I would have been taught ASL in the beginning, then I feel like I would have had more access to, I'm sorry, did somebody say something? No, I wasn't done. If I had access to ASL early on, I feel like I would have had a better command of the language as a young person.
Can I ask one more thing? Is there international sign language as well, or are you bilingual?
ASL is its own language for American Sign Language. I mean, I have learned some sign language. When we went to Europe, I met some people from the United Kingdom, from England. Of course, each country has their own sign language. We're not able to, you know, communicate really effectively, but we can generally understand because there's many signs that are very visual, and there is in the moment agreement of gesturing that's amazing. But I have never studied other sign languages, but we are able to gesture on a very superficial communication level because each country has its own sign language, and often we know our friends who we have good friends from Finland. We have friends from Germany. They have their own sign language, and they also, many of them can read English, but each of them have their own sign language. So it's dependent on their culture in that country. There's different languages. Oftentimes in a particular country, like for example in Europe, there may be different types of sign language even within one country. So no, it's not universal. Okay. You know, oftentimes, you know, if a country is close by one another and they do have exposure to one another, then they may all know the same sign language, but oftentimes no, very different.
So this is Sandy speaking from off screen. Hi. And can you also interpret? Okay. So I'm just going to address this question as well, because if it was a question about Matt or art, I would sit here and not say anything. But since it's Deaf Awareness Week, I'm going to throw in some more info to your question. So when we talk about the field of psychology two ways. If we're talking about identity, most deaf people with a deaf identity would sort of be insulted by the notion that they need to be healed because they feel whole as a deaf person, just different. Joke I often tell my students, if you pardon my French, is I'm a woman, I'm not penis impaired. Right? So I define myself by who I am, not what I'm missing compared to a group in power. Cognitively speaking, neuroscience speaking, did I make the humorist laugh? I missed that. Yes! brain tissue speaking, email me, because I'd love to send you some links from some outstanding research being done over the last decade at Gallaudet, proving that children, whether they're hearing, deaf, with an implant or with an aid, if they learn ASL first, the part of the brain that neuroscientists have thought was auditory for years is really just language. And those exposed to ASL outperform, say, someone with an implant who just uses English. So it's like fascinating new stuff coming out of neuroscience that you'd probably be fascinated with. So give me a link. I love this stuff. Matt, we are sort of out of time. let me check if there's someone with a burning question they want to relay.
Can you ask for advice?
Can you ask for advice? You can ask whatever question you want, sure. What's your question?
What advice would you have for a hard hearing man who's scared of being part of the deaf culture and deaf world?
Really, I feel like the point is, how do you find your own group? How do you feel comfortable? You have to feel comfortable in your own skin. I know that I'm comfortable in both cultures, deaf and hearing culture, because I grew up with a hearing family and I appreciate them. And I appreciate the hearing culture and I appreciate hearing people that can sign. I have the coolest friends in the world. They are hearing, and they learned some sign language from college. Their daughter and our son are friends in class. So we just met through school. And out of the blue, we just started talking. And he says, I know some sign language, and I want to talk to you. And we hit it off immediately. So he loves sign language. He loves learning sign language. And so based on, you know, our children being friends, we became friends, but also it was about the language. We could communicate with each other and we became friends. For you as a hard of hearing person, just find the right friends and the right people to feel comfortable with. It doesn't matter if you sign ASL or how you communicate with them, as long as you feel comfortable. Sometimes, when I talk, I have a weird voice, but I am okay with that. If my friends are bothered by that, if they're not bothered by that, then they become friends. If they don't like it, if they are bothered by my voice, well, then they're not going to be my friends, because I'm not going to change myself around to fit other people's expectations. You'll find the people that you need to be with in the world that support you and support your culture, and you just need to feel comfortable with that. If you want to be involved in the deaf world, then you learn about deaf people, you learn about ASL, you learn about the culture. But if you feel afraid and you feel it's too hard, that's okay too. It really all takes time. You'll find one deaf friend or one hard of hearing friend that has a similar experience to you, and that will be your comfort zone. So that's one of the ways. What is your needs? Decide what they are for you. Do you like reading lips? Do you like to sign? That's what you need to find for yourself. What is your identity? How do you identify yourself? I enjoy really everyone. I grew up oral. I understand when I meet people that are hard of hearing who are oral, we try to communicate the best that we can. I love deaf culture. I love ASL. So I'm multifaceted. I'm not just one thing. I'm very flexible. I think that's key.
Okay, well, we're going to wrap up there on that very positive note. Can everyone give a big round of applause to Matt for joining us today? And Matt, that website one more time is?
There's two. Well, there's www.thatdeafguy.com. And then, just thatdeafguy.com. That's pretty easy. And then on Facebook, you can just search us, or www.facebook.com/thatdeafguycomic. Okay.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you all.
Another round of applause. Matt, I'll be in touch.